Hey everybody, this is part two of using Piskel. In the first section I showed the basic tool usage and how to draw, and now we're going to take a look at the layers, this little preview panel, these transform options in the color palette as well. Okay, so just like in Photoshop, we have layers available to us. So if I draw something on this layer like this, and then I hit the plus button, then I can get a second layer. You can see the original one dims its content. Okay. Then on the second layer, I'll flip over to yellow and draw a little shape over top of that. Okay. Up here is a preview of what our pixel art actually looks like, and it's tiny. It's tiny because it's showing pixels, sorry, one-to-one right now. But we do have additional preview sizes. So if I do 6 times, this is a preview of our entire document, including layer 1 and layer 2 superimposed on each other. And we have a full as well. I guess this just fills the available size. 6 times, maybe that would be a little bit smaller than usual. We have a grid that we can turn on and off that you can see on our pixel art will appear, showing you where pixels can be placed. And it also gives us the option to pop this preview into another window entirely, which I think scales. Yeah, there we go. So if you really want to see a large version of your art, then you can pop out that window, maybe leave this on a second monitor or something like that. But typically I just use the 6 times or the full over here in the preview window, and that's enough for me. Okay. These layers can be renamed. If you'd like to, just click on the name twice, and we could call this one base, and we could call this one overlay, or whatever we want. There are options for rearranging these layers. The functionality is a little bit more limited than Photoshop or a full application, but we do have buttons for everything. If I wanted to move this layer beneath the base layer, I would click that arrow. Then you can see it becomes disabled. Then if I wanted to move it back up again, we could do that. Selecting the layer is as simple as clicking on them. Okay. We can edit the layer name right here as well. I didn't actually see that before. We can merge a layer with the one beneath it, which is interesting. If we wanted to use the temp layers option like we were doing with our control paint examples last week, I could draw something on a temporary layer so that I don't interfere with what's beneath, then click this button, and now they're both one layer, which is kind of nice as well. Okay. I'm going to click an additional layer, and let's just pick the red color I've been dealing with. Put some stripes over here. The little letter A on the right-hand side of each one of them is for opacity, and it's a little clunky because it brings up a pop-up. This number can be set between 0 and 1, so any decimal value will make this semi-transparent. So for instance, 0.5 will make this half visible, right? 50% opacity. You can only really see this in the preview window because when you have this selected, this layer, it becomes full opacity so that you can work with it more conveniently. We do also have the option to preview all layers or not, by the way. So here we're only seeing the current layer. Here we're only seeing the current layer. I'm going to leave that back on, though. And if I want to readjust that, we can change this to something else. 0.05, so 5% of its original value. You can see it's barely visible up here. And then back to 100%, we would just type in 1, and now it's a full overlay color. That would be most useful if you wanted to create shadow effects over the top of your existing art or something like that, or to make ghost kind of figures. It's a little bit confusing in the preview, but as long as you know what you're doing, then you can see what's happening up in the preview window up there. All right, beneath that, we have these transform options. You know what? I didn't even know. There's more tools than I ever even thought. Copy the sprite, copy, crop to fit the content or selection. Well, that's kind of nice. Applies to all frames and layers. I can see why they hid that one, because that could be disastrous if you did that on mistake. But we have a flip vertically, so we could flip horizontally, apply to all layers, or apply to all frames. So this art that I currently have on this layer, if I click this button, it will flop it to the right-hand side as opposed to the left, which is kind of nice. And if I hold down Alt, instead it will do that vertically. So nice utility. Okay. We can rotate things. Rotating pixel art tends to be kind of a pain, but this is going to make it a little bit easier to get perfect 90-degree rotations. Then it also says if we want to rotate the opposite way, Alt, Control to apply to all layers, and Shift to apply to all frames. Okay. So let's do the all layers one just because I do have 2 layers. So Control and then this, and both of those layers are now rotating around. clone. Clone the current layer to all frames. We can't use that one yet because we haven't done the animation section, but trust me, that's a very, very useful button. Okay. And finally, align image to center. So if you want to click that, it'll take the average of all the pixels that you have and just slap it in the center. Honestly, I never really use that. I would prefer to use the hand tool to slide it around manually, but it could be a nice time-saving feature if you wanted to do that quickly. All right, finally down here we have palettes. You may have noticed as I'm picking my colors, the most recently selected colors are popping up over here on the side, and I can reselect them again. And as long as I don't put in too many different color selections, they'll all fill in here somewhere, and then our normal color picker is right here. But palettes is different. Palettes is a set of saved colors that you're going to use long term, and I recommend that you use this if you're going to do anything more complicated than a simple doodle. If we select one of these colors, it immediately will jump to that color. We can manage this palette, so we could remove and add colors. We could mix them over here. Download this palette as a file, which is great, a way to save the color selection that you currently have. I'm going to delete this current palette. It says, am I sure? Yes, I am. And now it immediately filled in another selection. Like, what happened? Well, we had new palettes that I had made previously for tests and current colors. So if you're on current colors, every time you adjust to a brand new color, it's going to add it to the current color palette, which is great as long as you really mean it. Okay, so I have this blue now, and you can see these arrows. That refers to this is my secondary color, this is my primary color. If I select a new blue, like this one, draw with it, okay, it made a new palette entry, but that old one is still there. So I might want to remove that. It won't let me. So right-clicking will set it to the secondary color. I was hoping right-click might give me an option, but it didn't. I would have to come in to manage, I believe, and get rid of that color here. So while you're messing around with colors initially, this could be a bit annoying because all your different color selections will appear up here. But once you become sure that you want to keep something, then you can curate this list down and now rapidly select color to color without having to open up the palette in here, okay? Or I think I used the wrong word, the color picker, by using the palettes over here, okay? You can create a new palette, you can name it, you can stick to current colors if you want to. I believe we still have the option to download this as a file and name it as it is, which I think is the option that I would normally pick, but that is really nice functionality to be able to use, okay? A last little step here that I'll go over is what's going on in this menu, just for the sake of drawing and sizing. So your preferences, you can change what the background is viewable like. This is your full opacity transparency grid, which I find completely obnoxious. Here's a slightly higher contrast one. Here's a gray version, which could be nice, and a dark gray version. I just leave it on the default because I like it. Your layer opacity, if you don't want them to fade as much, you can turn this back up all the way to 100% where it doesn't fade at all. I usually leave it at the default or 25%, something like that. Maximum FPS, this is frames per second. We might alter this in the next video when we talk about animation. And your color format, you could set RGB or hex. This is just the code that is showing below the colors. I don't even bother with that. We do have the ability to change the grid sizing. I don't actually see it changing. Oh, because we're not viewing the grid. One second. I need to come to here. There we go. So there's the grid. And now we can thicken the grid so we can see more distinctly. I think that's kind of annoying. I don't even really enable the grid. Oh, there's a button for it right here. And the grid spacing, so let's see if I turn it back on. So now it's every 4 pixels, every second pixel, every first pixel. I don't know if you would want to use that feature or not, but it's up to you. And then the color as well. Ugh, this would just kill me. Yeah, I would hate that. So it's up to you, but I'm not going to use it. Finally, tiling mode, which is an interesting one. If I click tiling mode, you can see here are all the different tiles that are neighbors to each other. I really like this if you are going to make repeatable art. If we move, so we needed the hand tool, and we use Alt, then the tiles are all offsetting, at least on this single layer. I'm not moving the other one. And you can see how they're going to wrap with their next neighbors. If I fill that art back in a little bit, and then we use the hand and Alt again, Then I can move this back. We can kind of just see how it wraps around. And then this mask over here is showing what the neighboring art looks like. So you could contrive to swap to a blue, draw something up here which needs to connect like that, and then see it over on this side so that you can connect it and continue it off on that side. And just be sure that you know that your art is tiling. You can't draw directly into the mask, which I wish you could. That would be really great. But I guess it was a little bit too hard to figure out or something. But you can always just come over here and draw the rest of it. Okay. So that's preferences. We've got a resize tool. So here the default size of a Piskel file is 32 by 32 pixels. If we want to resize it, we can maintain the aspect ratio or not. We can resize the canvas content or not. This is off by default because scaling pixel art is another no-no that tends to go very wrong. And if you wanted to resize it from a particular location, we could pick a corner or the center. So just for the sake of argument, if I click this anchor, slip this to 64, which is double the size, and then click resize, the pixels will be left alone, but now they'll be floating in the upper left-hand corner with all of this new canvas space down here. I'm going to undo, and then one more time I'm going to resize it, but this time I'm going to let it resize the content. So we'll go 64, resize from, oh, it won't let me pick the corner now. Interesting. Anyway. Now we have a larger file, but look, my pixel size is half the size it was before. Okay, so all of these are now 4 pixels, 2x2, instead of a single pixel, which I find to be kind of misleading. Anyway, so I'll undo back to that. We do have save options. You can save as a .piskel file. That will only be openable within Piskel, either the offline app or the online app. But we do have a load option. That's a pretty good option because it saves all your animation information, all your palettes, all of your layers. So I do recommend that, but it's not compatible in any other program. Save in browser, which would mean I think you need to have a sign-in login for that. So I don't typically use that one. And you can give it a name and all that. We can import local save, so that would be on your computer or, yeah, from your, or actually if you saved in browser, that's what that would be. Load a Piskel file from your computer, right? And you can also import pictures such as PNGs, JPEGs, bitmaps, and animated GIFs even, which is a really nice one. I haven't experimented with opening existing animated GIFs, but that would be pretty cool to be able to see all the different frames broken out that way. So you can browse for that. And you can try to recover recent sessions as well. I'm not sure how reliable that is, but you do have the option. Finally, we have export options, so we can export a zip of all the different animation frames, which we'll have to get to in the next feature, a animated GIF that will loop or not, and a PNG, which is just exactly what is shown either in a sprite sheet, which is fantastic, or as these other versions that I'm not entirely sure about what these are. The final one, though, is just a single frame if you wanted to. The other one, export as a C file, I have no idea. If you need to figure out what that is, that's up to you, but I have no clue. Most often I would use probably a PNG because this is appropriate for game development. A zip would be nice too. You get individual files for every single frame, but I prefer to make a sprite sheet typically. And Piskel is capable of making a sprite sheet for you, which is a very nice feature. Okay. So that was just briefly the layer options, the preview, and some of the additional features. In the last section, I'll talk about the animation features of Piskel.